This is the Detroit Tigers Radio Network.
All right, let's get to it. He's back from Sugar Creek, Ohio. He's freshly eclipsed. He has reached the point of totality. Rico Beard rejoins us. How was your trip? How's everything? Are you ready to rock?
Yeah, I'm ready to go, man. Yes.
Where are your glasses?
They're at home.
You sure?
I'm positive. I'm
pretty sure we can show you what we thought of your activities yesterday on the big board a little later. Let's just get into this.
But I did take some photos for you.
So oh, I can't
I'll
wait.
Send them to you.
Sure, I'll get right on that. So we have the Red Wings game of the millennium that we're going to get to. But you have one thing you want to talk Tigers about. Comeback win today. Bednar implodes in the ninth. They get a much needed win because largely they were trash for these two games in Pittsburgh. They steal one today. You got to have a half a dozen of these at the end of a year if you're going to win a division. You got to straight up. Feloniously, you have to steal.
You do
half a dozen games.
When you look at the fact that you know the homeless A's came in here and took a series and just you know in the final two games, just almost blanked you. You got to run. Congratulations. But I did. I said, can you go 7-4 to start the year off? And guess what? They backdoored their way into 7-4 today. The comeback victory. Can't be angry because that was the goal that I set to start the year off. You're playing bad teams. You beat the bad teams. Now, what's next? What's the next benchmark for this team? Because I look at the month of April. 20 games left. Fitting we played the April in the D. You got 20 games left.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? 7 games against the Twins. 4 games against the Rangers. 3 games on the road at Tampa. 3 games against Kansas City, and then you got 3 games against St. Louis. Those teams, a lot of them are like kind of where you are in the middle. 13 of the games of the 20 are right here in Detroit. That's my next benchmark for this team. Where are you at the end of April? You were 7-4. Can you at least? Mike is 13-7, asking for too much.
No, not if you're any good. I mean, the Twins suck.
Right.
You got like 50 games against them coming up.
Right. You got the 4 here, and then you got an...
We're losing them. We're losing them. The Eclipse got them.
You got 4 here, and then you got another 3 there. So that's 7 games.
I don't think you're wrong. I mean, for me, I can't even get to the numbers. See, you're not gonna like what... I know you listened a little bit yesterday on your drive down to Sugar Creek. It was more, my first checkpoint would be.
By the way,
I
just want to let you know how much I hate you, but we'll get into that later.
You're welcome. Man, I need him to be watchable. Yeah, you won the game today. I mean, that it was an hour and 57 minutes of garbage, and then I got about 6 minutes of fun. The reality is they're not watchable. This offense is bad. And every pitcher not named Scooble is a major question mark. Like today, hey, Mize got helped out by Riley Green in a big way. The reality, Casey Mize can't miss bats.
They're not watchable, but here's the thing. I did hear you mention this. It's games like this that may be the difference with you winning a division or not having to play in game 163.
Especially on the heels of what went down against the A's this week. And I agree with you totally. I'm fine taking the wins, but you're asking me, like, what's next? Yes, 13-7 the rest of the way for a record that would be, what, 20-10 or 20-13 or whatever? Yes, I mean, show me a nice...
20-11.
Yeah, show me a nice start to the season. We can work out some of the problems down the line. I know for me to get really excited, they've just got to basically be a different team because you're not going to win games this way. But, no, I don't think you're wrong. Listen. You know my viewpoint on expectations. I think this town is very low on them. I this division is so bad. I watch more baseball than anybody. These teams are awful. If you're telling me the Guardians are the best of the bunch, which currently they are, they have question marks. One of their best arms is now dead in Shane Bieber. You know, they have an offense right now where Angel Jimenez is like hitting like Babe Ruth. Is that going to continue? The bottom line is the rest of these teams are bad. So, Rico, no, you're not wrong to have that expectation. You know, the St. Louis Cardinals have a cool logo and a rich history. I don't think this is a very good baseball team. They really struggle to score. So it's like, all right, no, you're not wrong to say, Mike, go 13-7 over the next 20. Build on the 7-4. And no, I don't think you're wrong to say, hey, be 20-11, be 19-12, be be 18-13.
I was about to say, to me, the floor is 17-14. That means you win 10-10.
I can't do that.
No, you went 10-10. No, no. But because you jumped out to this lead to start off, that's why these games against bad teams were so important, because it allowed you the equity to build up that when you hit the slump, you still had a little bit of wiggle room. So 10-10, to me, is the absolute worst that you can do. You cannot finish the month in these next 20 games with a losing record. You have to at least win 10 games. Now, I would like to see more than that, because then, once we've said it before, division is yours for the having.
Or at least
whether your general manager believes that or not, you should be able to win this thing, okay? You get Minnesota. Minnesota's not a good team this year.
You got a lot of bad teams on the schedule.
Let's take advantage of them.
You play who's on your schedule, and therefore, Rico, look at it this way. If through the first 31 games, you're 20-11, all right, you've allowed yourself to play 500 ball in a different 30-game span and probably still be in this thing.
Right.
Or, God forbid, you have a bad 30-game set. You play 4 or 5 games under. It's not going to ruin you. Look, I just...
Because I can't understand that this team has this... I don't know if it's a sense of urgency. You saw it today where they all of a sudden scored a bunch of runs in the ninth. They score runs in extra innings. It's like, okay, guys, it'd be nice if you just did this in like the second inning.
Look, I'll give Green credit for the walk and Urshela hit a ball. I mean, a couple of them are bleeders. You got Bednar hitting Torkelson. You got Pittsburgh's manager inexplicably not walking Carpenter to get Tobias. You take the gift. No, you just take the gift. But like, I'm not going to sit here and act like all of a sudden this was a real scoring parade. You stole the game. Get the hell out of there. Because getting swept by the Pirates, that doesn't work. That's ridiculous. Especially the way they played last night.
Yeah, it was funny.
I think 13-7 over the next 20 would be a real positive sign. Real sign, like, you know what? And I would assume, this is dangerous, assumptions kill. I would assume if they go 13-7 in the next 20, the offense will have picked it up. That they will become more watchable. We'll have less of Jack Flaherty bad.
If the weather gets warmer, the bats will warm up.
Well, and Maeda, notoriously bad in April, I'd like to think he can pick it up a little. Look, man, it's a long year. But I don't think you're wrong to have an expectation that at the end of April, be 7, 8, 9 games over 500. That's how I look at it. You can't play the schedule. In baseball, you can more, because it's a lot like the NBA. A lot of the teams aren't trying.
Mm-hmm.
It's just reality.
So, I'm not looking past into May and June. No. I'm looking at the next 20 games. You got winnable games on your schedule. 248-539-9797. What's your new benchmark for this team? I said 7-4, and my goodness, they barely made it. But as of right now,
they made it.
They're 7-4. What do you do next? Because I say 13-7 to me, man. You finished out the month strong. Yeah,
you had the best April in what? They haven't been above 500 in April since 2016. I believe you're right. I'd have to go back further to go, all right, well, when's the last time they were 9 games over? Look, that's part of unwinding your negative image. You gotta eliminate some of the bad things. You gotta be able to accomplish stuff like we saw the Lions do it in living color.
Mm-hmm.
You want the respect, you gotta start doing things you haven't done. So, I don't think it's unfair. I don't think it's crazy either. The pitching will be fine. I understand every starter not named Mize has gotten touched up here the second time through. I don't think they're that bad. Okay? I don't think the pen is this good. I mean, but the pen is good.
They're getting the job done.
It's a matter of, is this lineup, how much better is this lineup than what they're giving? And I don't have that answer. I really don't. Because if you're intent on Mark Canna carrying your baseball team, you may as well pack it up.
Well, you got Gio as well.
Hey, God bless. Yeah. I mean, I loved him as a part-time player with my Yankees, but that's not an everyday third baseman.
Right, they have limits, so 13-7, that's what I'm looking for.
I would love to see it, and I think it's within the realm of possibility.
Worst case scenario, because you did the 7-4, I can even drop it down to 10-10. Still leaves you at 17-14 at the end of the month. You're still above. You're north of 500. You got a little bit of cushion.
Do you at least understand, and I know you weren't here yesterday, it is very hard for someone like me who's held the opinion, not only about the way they went in the draft, but what they didn't do in the offseason. Now that we're seeing it actually play out, not just you, because you're right. Ugly 7-4 is better than a pretty 4-7. I get that. But when you're watching this division, where we had an inkling, all right, this division's going to be bad. Shane Bieber's dead. Royce Lewis is dead. The White Sox never should have broke camp. I mean, you start to look at it. Rico, they're 10 games into the year. You know how many runs the White Sox have scored?
How many?
16.
Wow.
It's hard for me to be like, man, what if they had done so? I mean, you could.
No, it angers you.
That's the
same, the same way I felt, you know, the Lions. It was like, man, what if you would have added that extra pass rusher? Would that have been the difference maker?
Maybe.
Right, because it leads you to speculation. Like, man, you were so close. Why not take advantage? Because in this world of sports, man, sometimes you're given this perfect scenario, but you got to take advantage of it. And I don't feel like Detroit's taking any advantage of this division, of this scenario. Yeah.
There's an element to the team. I think some of it, like the way they're winning games is not sustainable. But there are elements of it that are. I mean, defensively, I think they're good. I do. Pitching, good. I don't know that it's going to be great, but good. Pen, very good. The pen right now is damn near unhittable. It's this lineup. How much better can this lineup be than what it is? I don't have that answer.
Yeah.
I have doubts, but we're going to find out.
Well, I will say this. Yeah, I like, and we've said this before, you're handing the other team an extra set of three outs, because every time you put Javi Baez out there, you're saying we can see three.
Well, hell,
might as well put the pitcher out there.
It's kind of him and Parker Meadows. You're basically handing six outs, seven outs. So that's a bit of an issue. And then obviously, if a guy like Torkelson's going to scuffle the way he has, I know he had a single today, but you get my point. It's just you have time, and as long as you're able to grind and win and steal a game like you did today, you have time to figure it out. Hell, man, they're a team like Toronto right now, for the talent they have. They're playing awful. I'd much rather be 7-4 than 4-7. But ultimately, I think you got to begin developing stuff you can believe in. You know, things you can plant the flag and go, this is who we are.
And I guess I'm looking bigger picture. If you can stay north of 500, if you can be competitive in this division,
could you force Scott Harris to actually have an expectation of winning? Because
and the fact that maybe you go out at the trade deadline and you're a buyer.
I would love it. And that's all I'm begging for is, can we get to 4th of July in a command position?
And now you can go out there and you can get a bat or two to add to this lineup.
We're fine. We like our flexibility.
You know, because you could have had two bats and you not have to trade anybody. But, yeah, sure.
248-539-9797. We'll get a couple of phone calls in the mix. And, yes, Red Wings game of the millennium. We got to get to it. We also have thoughts on a national title game. Hey, boiler up.
We were close.
I hate Purdue.
We were close.
That school shuttered.
That was the team that I picked at the beginning. And
good.
Like, oh!
Let it burn. 97-1.
Let's talk about the Chevy dealer in the area leading the way. It's Hamilton Chevrolet in Warren. Rev up and drive with unbeatable deals at Hamilton. Andrew and his sales staff want to be your Chevy dealer. It's time to hit the road in style. Hamilton is your go-to destination for top-notch vehicles and savings, sleek and powerful cars ready to conquer the road. And Hamilton Chevy has them all, from fuel-efficient compacts to rugged SUVs. 75 and sunny, you know what that means? Convertible. Hamilton has it. They got wheels to match your lifestyle. With Hamilton, you know you're getting excellence. It's not just about selling cars. It's about delivering unmatched driving experience. They're more than just a dealership. It's a commitment to quality and customer satisfaction. And right now, take advantage of the April Rico deal. A new 2024 Chevy Equinox. $279 a month for 24 months. You walk in with $995 down. You drive away with 10,000 miles a year. The best deals are found at 14 Mile and Mound. Stop in to see my guys at Hamilton Chevrolet for details. Tell them Rico sent you. More at HamiltonChevy.com. Chevrolet, together, let's drive.
Wings fans, we got you covered. We'll get to it a little later. It is the biggest game of the Yzerman era, and maybe a little fun angle outside of the Lions. Leave it alone. Between the Tigers, the Red Wings, and the Pistons. Tonight's game against the Caps is the biggest regular game, regular season game since ... When is the last time we had a regular season game of the millennium?
Outside of the Lions.
Mm-hmm. We'll get to it. We got lots to do. And we're going to get to UConn. And I do need one segment between now and six. I got to get your thoughts on Calipari. It's the wildest damn thing I've ever seen. That's all.
I sent you the message and you're like, okay, wow. Now go enjoy your time with Captain Kirk.
That's it. Not quite the same words, but yes. All right, let's go to Connor, Lincoln Park. Connor, how are you? And Connor.
Connor.
There he is.
Hello?
I hear him. Connor, how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing good. How about you, fellas?
Not bad. What's on your mind?
All right, well, first thing, I'm happy the Tigers won, all right? But second thing, I hope Bobby Baez is hurt and he just goes and rehabs in Puerto Rico and he doesn't come back, honestly. That's point number one. And point number two, what is Scott Harris talking about? He came, yeah, bad division, right? But he came in second place last year. How do you not have higher expectations for this year?
All right, are you referring, I just, Connor, for the rest of the people who might not be clued in, are you referring to his interview with Chris Russo on High Heat?
I believe so, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. All right, we have the audio and I'll play it. Basically, Scott Harris said we haven't earned the right to have expectations, etc. I was annoyed by it, Connor, big time, but we were going to save that for tomorrow. But go ahead.
I apologize.
No, don't apologize. Let's talk.
Well, I mean, it's obvious he doesn't have expectations because he brought in two major league career average bats in Gio Urshela and Mark Canha, and he brought in the dead body of Flaherty and a guy that throws 89 miles an hour on the bump. Like, what are we doing?
No, Connor, I'll tell you what it is. I know you won't like it. I don't like it. He doesn't have a boss. You think the owner cares? You think the owner is heavily? You think the owner had his feet up today watching this game, chewing his fingernails, hoping a bloop fell it? Come on, like you're not.
Oh, no.
That's not what we're operating.
His assistant walk
with.
In and say, "Hey, your team won.
Who won the match today?" So it just
that's
the reality.
All I know is his father is rolling in his grave, watching him drive this baseball team into the dirt. That's all I know.
The thing we got to hope for, and you know my feelings on hope. I'm not a huge fan of it. You got to hope Scott Harris ends up being right long term. You get a bunch of scrubs and you have this miracle thing. But overall, I just, until or unless I start to see four or five real bats. I mean, like, look, I'm not even going to use teams like, forget about the Yankees, the Dodgers, stuff like that. Like, hell, look at Baltimore. Look at how Atlanta has built themselves. I mean, pick a franchise that's worth watching, okay? Look at the Diamondbacks. Guys, where are the bats? And unfortunately, like, look at what you did this past summer. You drafted a high schooler instead of taking a guy ready to play.
You need some of these players to blossom. You need a couple of players to be early bloomers so you could say, yep, okay, I now see why you have faith in these people and why you think that this is going to work. But right now, it's like we're watching a pot trying to boil, like, okay, anytime now, do something.
I can play the audio for the people. I really want to do it tomorrow, but let me at least, if you're listening and you're like, what is Connor and what are the guys talking about? Here's what Scott Harris said that Connor was referring to. He was on High Heat with Chris Russo, MLB Network. You finished second in the division last year. Not last. You didn't win 53 games. Now the expectations aren't different than last year. We haven't earned the right to expectations to talk about playoff berths.
Just gonna roll with the young guys.
Here's the other one. The thing that scares me most is what I've been telling you guys. Yeah, we got to rely on the veterans we brought in. All right, so we're relying on Mark Canha, Gio Urshela, Carson Kelly. Okay. In the words of Liam Neeson, good luck. I'll enjoy it for what it is, but I just feel like there's so much more there. Mm-hmm. Like, we really, I don't understand the lack of urgency by this franchise.
If you were going to do that, then why not just, you know, go after JD Martinez for a year? Since you want to rely on veterans, bring him back.
They like their flexibility in their DH spot. Don't you listen? I'm being sarcastic, but that's how
dude. I mean, he is relying.
This is Moneyball. You have to accept it. Brad Pitt and Jonah Hill aren't here, all right? But that's what this is. I hope you understand it. The difference is the manager doesn't fight you on it. They're all aligned. They want to have a big box of Legos and figure it out every night. That's fine. They can do whatever the hell they want. It's not my money. But I don't have to like it. And look, Rico, yesterday, phone lines were flooded with people saying I'm happy they're winning, but I don't enjoy it. This isn't enjoyable. No. And it's not sustainable.
No.
So last night they were dreadful. Today they were dreadful for eight innings. And you stole one. And I'll always take it. It's a freebie. It's like finding a dollar on the ground. You'll take it.
Right.
But that's not sustainable. And it wasn't enjoyable.
No, because you're almost waiting for the other shoe to fall. Bottom to fall out and say, okay, here we are. Now we started off this way. I guess if you look at it, kind of like how the Pistons started off 2-1, and you thought, okay, maybe this is going to be different. No, it's not.
248-539-9797. We can get more of your phone calls on it. We don't have to be exclusively Red Wings. So if you have Tiger thoughts, please. If you have thoughts on what you heard there with Scotty Harris, it's just something very simple to me. Why is it okay to not have expectations? When you hear that from your president of baseball operations, I think that's pretty scary.
Yeah, he punted. He basically punted this season.
Sure.
Is what it sounded like to me.
Now, hopefully this team forces him to rethink that strategy. That's our hope. If you're a fan like me who wants this team to be good, wants playoff baseball, wants a stretch drive.
I couldn't believe what I heard. I was like, wow, he just conceded this year and said, yeah, we're not really expecting to do anything because we're not in that position yet. What?
Hey, let's just focus on the task at hand. I'm like, all right. Sick. 97.1.
Brought to you by National Benefit Plans. The Tigers score 4 runs in the 9th inning, completing a 5-3 comeback win over the Pirates, also salvaging a 2-game split. A single from Gio Urshela and then a throwing error tied this one up at 3. That set up the pinch hitter then, Kerry Carpenter. The Tigers will get one more run in the 9th on an RBI single from Jake Rogers. Jason Foley slammed the door closed in the bottom of the inning. Detroit's off tomorrow. They open a 4-game series Thursday against the Twins at Comerica Park. The Red Wings host the Capitals this evening at Little Caesars Arena. This one's huge for the wild card race. The Wings holding down that second spot right now with 84 points. The Penguins, the first team out, also at 84 points. Then it's the Caps and Flyers at 83 points each. Mo Sider is sick, but will likely suit up tonight, according to Derek Lalonde. Michael Rasmussen is out. Alex Lyon's going to start in goal. Puck drop between the Wings and Caps, 7 o'clock. The pregame show at 6:45 right here on 97.1. Also, the Pistons looking to snap a 4-game losing streak at the Sixers this evening. Only 4 games left this season. Tip off at 7 o'clock over on WWJ. At the Coral Health Sports Desk, I'm Luke Sloan. For more, go to 97.1 The Ticket or Odyssey.com.
All right, so we will get to your Tiger calls momentarily. I want to mix in the Wings a little bit, though, too. It is. It's the biggest game of Yzerman's tenure. It is a de facto playoff game. You're up 1 point on the Caps. You can handle your business. I don't want to hear about what comes up later in the week on Thursday night. None of that matters. You win tonight, you're in a command position. You lose tonight, you're in some trouble, period. Don't make excuses. Don't come up with scenario. Just win. But here's the problem. There are two things. A, I'd like to know when is the last time we had a regular season game this big? That's not the Lions. When is it? Tigers, Pistons, Wings. Last time you had a regular season game this big? I don't have the answer. I'm openly asking you in listener land. But part two of it is, why am I not more confident? The Caps have lost 6 in a row. They're playing timid hockey at best. I mean, the Senators had them hemmed in all over the place. They were playing the Caps have never been viewed as good, but they're playing their worst hockey of the season at the worst moment. They're coming here, and I mean, nothing says big game matchup like Lindgren versus Lyon between the pipes. I mean, this is shades of Brodeur versus Waugh. Why am I not more confident? Because I'm actually terrified of tonight.
It is very simple, I think. And it's because every time last year and this year, you thought this team figured it out, and they were a playoff team.
They hurt you.
They just fall down the stairs. Nobody pushed them. They just fell. They just tripped. And you're sitting there saying, what just happened here? All you had to do was just go out there and just keep playing that same way. Whenever the expectations got high, they couldn't rise to it.
And like tonight, you're at home. You've played better hockey. The Caps are spiraling. And yet, this would be the type of game they would dump. This would be the type of game that they would just, I don't know why. I want to believe, Kenny, feel free to jump in. I don't know why I'm not more confident.
I know why you're not confident. Is because this team basically put bullets in you during that losing streak. Too many I'm serious. Too many bullets to overcome. Because, Mike, I feel the same way.
You're nervous.
Every Wings game that for at least the last week or so, I've sat down on my couch to watch and I've got, here we go. Here we go again with this team. Before the game even starts, I'm upset because I think they're going to make me upset during the game.
You just described my relationship with Michigan State.
Here we go. Here we go. I see Ken and like Mick Mike, on the call. Here we go.
Like, Mike, they just walked out the tunnel. I don't care.
I didn't like their body language.
We saw them not try against the Coyotes. We saw them not try against Buffalo. We saw them in a 7-game losing streak. I think we saw that so recently that we're still in the mindset of, well, we don't know what's going to happen tonight.
Here's the other thing that's strange. I mean, if you're not following the playoff chase closely, really weird stuff. I mean, the Flyers, a 7-game losing streak. The Caps, a 6-game losing streak. The Islanders were awful. Now they've rattled 5 in a row off. It's this, the volatility between all these teams. It's like if you can just play 500 hockey, somehow you've awoken in a playoff spot.
They're playing hot potato with that last wild card spot, man. It's Nobody wants it. I got it. You take it.
Yes, yeah, very strange. It's like watching the hot dog race at the ballpark. Like, okay, nope, they're in the lead. Nope, now they're in the lead. Nope, now they're in the lead.
What's the last time we had a regular season game this big? Non-Lions. See, I'd love the listeners to participate. What is it?
I have one, but I feel like you're going to hit me with a chair.
No, I'm not.
It the Pistons beating, was it the Nets? No. Who did they beat to not get the record?
Raptors. Day they traded OG Anunoby.
Yeah. That may be.
Okay, I'm not going to hit you with a chair, but that doesn't qualify.
I'm just saying they didn't get the record.
That was a spite win.
Okay.
I'm talking about playoff implications. I'm talking about a game that even if you're not a huge fan of the team, you could have that game on tonight. That the Wings are in a de facto playoff game. That if they lose, I think it greatly damages their chances of getting in. And if they win, I think they end up in the command position. Rico, I don't have an answer. Now, if I take away what the Lions did last season, you know, is there a game somewhere in the Pistons during the faux playoff year? I don't have it. I don't have it offhand. If it's the Tigers, I mean, we just got done talking about how they haven't been remotely relevant in, what, 9 years? And if it's the Wings, I mean, you're going back almost the same amount of time. Think about that.
The series with Vancouver last year with the Wings.
You mean Ottawa? When it ruined their playoffs?
Yeah, they got in and then Ottawa beat them like 12-2 over the course of two nights. Yeah. I am asking... Because, again, the Wings have what? They have 77 games played, so 5 games to go. Rico, end of the year, real implications.
I can't think of anything for the Tigers.
Could it be for the Tigers, the Miggy milestone watch games when he was right there?
Now you get the chair.
All right. Because, honestly, in this town, it doesn't feel like there's been a game big enough in the last, what, decade
but
that you
can
point to and say that's an important game right
there. That's why it's exciting. And I think any game that's big, you do get nervous. And the nerves are a natural function of allowing what you could lose to enter your headspace.
The biggest games probably in the last 10 years, Mike, may have come from the college ranks.
That doesn't count.
No, I'm just saying, like, that Michigan-Ohio State game.
Yeah, it doesn't count.
I'm just saying, that was probably the biggest where you felt like
but you gotta
there's
like college
so
sports.
Much on the line here. Like, man, if you win... Everything's ahead of you.
And make no mistake, this is absolutely the biggest game of Iserman's tenure. I mean, think about how much is on the line of how we're going to view the Iser plan if they win or if they lose. Because, again, I think if they lose, they're in big trouble where they're going to be an underdog to make it. If they win, minus 200. Like they are going to be in a command spot. And you know what part of me actually makes me more nervous? Here, go ahead and hit me with a chair. I hate the fact that Washington's coming in having lost 6 in a row because you get their most desperate
feel like
shot.
Overdue.
And they just lost to a Senator team they got no business losing to. They lost in heartbreaking fashion. And I actually hate it when another team's on a long losing streak because whatever Washington's got, you're going to get tonight. That's it. I don't know. And again, it's two different questions. You have the... When is the last time we had a regular season game mean this much in this town? But also, are you nervous? Is it wrong that I am very nervous about tonight? And it's because Eddie Mush, a.k.a. Jim Costa, will be in the building.
He also gave a Costa lock. Yeah, what you want to see is, you know, what they did a lot, just 53 seconds into the game, score, take a seat, everybody.
I'm worried because Costa's there. I think he's a bad omen. I'm worried because this Wings team, every time I feel like...
What happened the last time he was there?
They lost 8-3 or whatever it was.
Was that the Avalanche game?
Yes. Jeez, he's a bad omen.
I was about to say, he didn't help out Central Michigan.
This is bad, guys.
And it's not bad.
Stop talking like this.
No, it's not bad. I just think of will it be joy or relief if they win?
Relief. 100% relief. The joy will come when they clinch the playoffs. I will be able to enjoy myself.
It's relief on to the next game.
Right.
Anxiety,
exactly.
Still there. Yeah.
By the way, rinse and repeat to the next game, because this is exactly how I'm going to feel against Pittsburgh.
Kenny, pop another Tums.
But if they win tonight, it takes away some of the stress of Thursday. And you will all but put the caps on the outs. It is all there. So let's talk about it. And if you have an idea the last time a game was this important in the regular season for any of our local teams, not named the Lions, I'd love to hear from you, because I'm struggling to come up with one. 248-539-9797. We'll get your phone calls next. In an instant, an auto accident can put you in the worst financial position of your life. You have got to hire the right lawyer to make sure the insurance companies pay what they owe you. Injury attorney David Feminino and his team, they have been making insurance companies pay for 30 years, and they'll help you with your case. David's ready to talk to you personally right now. If you call 855-65-CRASH or go to that website, getdavidgetpaid.com. All right, let's get to it. We're going to get to the phones here in a moment. Kenny on the Ticket Text, game of the millennium for the Wings. Wings caps tonight. Costa will be there. They lose. It's on him. You can talk to him tomorrow morning. I'm nervous. I don't like it when he shows up. He's a bad omen. I'm also very nervous because that's what the Wings make me. They're just every time you believe, it's Lucy with the football.
Costa will be there in Jersey, I'm sure. He could be the good luck charm.
Okay.
I thought him and the wife went and they actually won a game.
Erroneous.
He put it all over social
media. I'm sure it's happened by accident, but I think they have a losing record across the board with sports.
Well, you know what? If you see him on camera tonight, I had nothing to do with it.
Fair. What do you got, Kenny?
Mike, Wings game tonight. I'm terrified as well. Paul and the D.
And I don't want to be. I'd love to be supremely confident. But this team, every time you buy them, man, they got a way of hurting you.
And I think that's why you have the fear.
I know.
It's because 2 years in a row, we got the car flags going. It was like, yes.
I don't even think about last year. I'm not even kidding you. This is all about this year. What a row. I don't know a playoff push like this. I've never seen anything like this. Go ahead, Kenny.
How come it seems like nobody in the Eastern Conference wants the last playoff spot? Everybody keeps losing and losing and losing.
7-game losing streak for the Flyers, 6-game losing streak for the Caps. The Islanders, who were trash going like 2-7-1 in a 10-game span, now have won 5 in a row. I cannot figure it out.
It's like the hot dog race at the ballpark. They just push each other down and
wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
This team started to make me believe, and that's exactly why I'm nervous, afraid to get my heart broken again, second time this season. That's from Bill. That's where I'm at, man. I feel like there's a real risk here of starting to fall in love with the team. Remember when they were winning all those games, and you're mm-hmm. like, this is the team. We're third in the Atlantic. This team's going to the playoffs. It's a lock. That's what terrifies me the most is, yeah, we've been winning a little bit. We've been playing a little bit better. Having that confidence, that makes you nervous.
Okay, Kenny, would you take that deal now?
No, absolutely.
Go to hell, Erroneous. How dare you? Right. You caught Kenny in a weak moment in late February when they were on fire. You don't use that against him.
No, right? I'm saying, what do you do it now?
It's that gotcha politics.
I got
you.
Stop it
right now.
I would give you the number, the only answer really coming in on Ticket Text regarding the biggest regular season game, but we have it on line 6 if you want to go to that call.
Okay, Jim 97.1. Hi, Jim.
Good afternoon, Michael. How are you?
Excellent. What do you got for us?
Tigers, 2009, game 163.
All right, the only reason I can't go there is because they made the World Series in 12. They had multiple playoff pushes in years after. That's very difficult that there wouldn't be something in that span in the regular season. But, man, you're right. It was game 163. Yes, the ball went off Inge's jersey. It just, winning you're in, losing you're out. There was finality to it.
That was it, Matt. That's why that was my statement, my choice.
I'm not mad at you. It's not terrible. It's sad. But yes, just I have to believe if we ran a fine-tooth comb over the 2012 season or 13 or 14, there would be something. But you're right. There was finality to it. There's not that level of finality tonight, but if the Wings lose this game, it puts them really in a bad spot. If they win it, they're in a really good spot. Uh-oh. What?
No. I'm just trying to think of another game. But no, you're right. They're not done, but it's going to make it very difficult.
Go to Nick 97.1. What's up, Nick? How you doing?
Hey, Mike. It's me again. So, yeah, today's game. Look, Mike, does it make me a bad fan that I got extremely annoyed and even somewhat angry the way they won that game? And, it's kind of like how Kenny feels about the Wings tonight. And he's like, oh, what a doomer. But, like, they've been getting off these awful starts, and they got off to another one of these awful starts, and I'm just like, oh, here we go again, and it's the eighth inning. And then by this point, I'm like, just go out and lose.
Yes,
and then
okay.
Bad darn close.
Nick, but I'm going to say this. You're not alone. I happened to witness somebody who felt the same way. So you are not alone that it annoyed you how they won the game.
Yeah, today. I don't like the cardiac cats routine. If you're not going to participate in the first 8 innings, then just kindly leave.
You know, it's so frustrating because Casey Mize, actually, he pitched pretty well today, but he got zero run support. Like, when that last inning happened and Taylor threw the ball away, I switched the game off. I stopped listening, and because that kind of brand of baseball is not the same brand of baseball that I want. It's the same brand we've been following for the last 10 weeks. It feels like all we've done is backdoor into these wins. And, you know, we haven't – here's the bigger point I want to make. We haven't had, like, a single performance yet where the Tigers came out fully awake, announced their presence with authority on offense, and just, like, dominated a team. It's always these one-run games go to extras and explode and score four runs and come back. Never has it been that the Tigers were in complete control of the game where we're just spraying the ball all over the field. But, you know, what I don't need to go 13-7 over these next 20 games. You know, you're playing the Twins next, who look dreadful and lifeless. It will be so nice for once if you actually, for the first time this year, you know, got off to a really good start on offense instead of doing this more of the same, getting abused by Martin Perez for 7 to 8 innings and then suddenly waking up at the end. And then, you know, then you go to Texas, who's a much better team. And then if you want to do these one-run games, that's fine. But I don't need to see the pitching do this because I know that they're good. I need to see the offense take the step forward. And I don't know how, you know, I don't know.
And Nick, here's the thing. You know, we talked early in spring training and we saw the schedule. And yeah, I mean, this is the softest 10 or 11 game run you're going to have, period. So you went 7-4. You're not going to win any beauty contest, that's for sure. The mark of this team is going to be what they do moving forward, because frankly, these teams can't hurt you. They're terrible. And don't hit me with this Pirates thing. All right. If they win 75 games, it's a miracle. They're a bad baseball team. All right.
They could be you right now, where the record is not indicative of what the team is going to be in the end. But you got Minnesota, 7 games coming up against them. Let's see what you do in the next 20 games. If the worst you do is 10-10, you're still ahead of, you're still north of 500 going into May. The goal is to become buyers, to buy a bat or two to really get this thing going, because I think that's what's really missing from the team. We talked about it earlier in the show. If you missed it, you can use the Odyssey Rewind, but the pitching, the bullpen, defense, it's all there. It's just the lack of hitting and scoring of runs. So
yeah, that whole thing. Yeah. You know, baseball. 248-539-9797. We'll get more of the calls. We got a blitz to get to. A little bit of conversation about UConn last night, and obviously Red Wing hockey elite. Let's get to it. It's the game of the millennium. It's as big of a regular season game as you've had, I don't know, close to 10 years. Feels like it. Something the Tigers don't do a lot of, home runs. People love them. FanDuel will let you bet on them. FanDuel Dinger Tuesdays. All you do is this. It's America's number one sports book. You bet on a player to hit a home run. FanDuel will give you $5 in bonus bets for every home run hit during that game. And if you need another reason to love the home run, FanDuel.com/ticket. Get in on all the action. FanDuel.com/ticket. Make every moment more with FanDuel, the official sports betting partner of Major League Baseball. 21 and up, present Michigan. Bonus issued, non-withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. Max bonus, $25 per game. Restrictions apply. See terms, sportsbook.fanduel.com. You got a gambling problem, call 1-800-GAMBLER.
Brought to you by Twin Peaks. The Tigers beat the Pirates this afternoon, 5-3 the final, scoring four runs in the ninth inning to leave Pittsburgh with a two-game series split. Gio Urshela got this comeback started with a little bit of help from the Buccos. Kerry Carpenter then knocked an RBI single, giving the Tigers a 4-3 lead. They get one more run on a single from Jake Rogers. Jason Foley earning the save, and next up for Detroit, a well-deserved day off tomorrow, then a four-game series against the Twins that starts Thursday at Comerica Park. Wings host the Capitals this evening at Little Caesars Arena. Detroit holds the second wild card spot right now at 84 points. Washington's got 83 points. Mo Sider is sick, but head coach Jarek Lalonde says he'll likely suit up tonight. Alex Lyon will start in goal. That puck drop between the Wings and Caps right here on 97.1 at 7 o'clock. The pregame show at 6:45. At the Corwell Health Sports Desk, I'm Luke Sloan. We've got more at 5 o'clock or at 97.1theticket.com.
So, I think I may have the game. Now, you'd have to go back 5 years, which, again, how pathetic is this? And here's the problem. We all want the Wings to make the playoffs. There's not a single person, if you call yourself remotely interested in Detroit sports, who doesn't want them to make the playoffs. I can't say that about the game I'm thinking about. It would be 2019, Pistons-Knicks. Pistons have to win to make the playoffs. One problem. It was a 50-50 split. The idiot portion of society wanted the Pistons to get in. Those of us who hated the entire Blake thing and knew it would lead them to bad decisions wanted them to lose. See, you can't say that about tonight. This is the biggest game of Yzerman's tenure here. And it's a game that unilaterally, we all want them to win. So we're rapping about that. I am nervous about it. I know Kenny is too. And it's because of how this team has, every time you want to believe, they hurt you. Every time you want to give up, they bounce back. I don't know. So we're rapping about that. And we do have some Tiger calls. You know, they stole one today. They were awful in Pittsburgh for roughly 17 innings. And ninth inning today, you get a walk. Torkelson gets beaned. All of a sudden, you get a little momentum. You get a throwing error. You get a bloop. I don't care. Fine. You stole one. That doesn't make me feel better about them. Also, like, if you want to nerd out, like, I'm just, Casey Mize cannot miss bats. He can't. I don't want to hear about how much life and, oh, this is the best splitter I've seen since Auburn. Really? 2 Ks. What do you have in the first game? Like, 3 Ks. You're not going to survive like this. So you know what that makes Mize? That'll make him a fifth starter. That's not what I took you number one overall for. So, look, there's time.
He's working his way back in.
Exactly. I'm not, but, like, I look at things on a case-by-case basis. That's how I am as a baseball fan. Watch game, analyze game, move to next. Let's go to Paul, 97.1. Paulie, what's going on, buddy?
Hey, what's going on, Mikey? How are you?
I'm good. What's going on?
So first of all, I just wanted to give Rico a little crap here. Rico, you're such a weirdo, man, driving all the way to see an eclipse. You know, that's a behavior I would expect out of Stoney. You know, the guy who, oh, guys,
Paul, real quick, when I woke up this morning, why do I give a damn what you think?
Oh, Jesus. Oh, Lord, here we go.
I'm just curious.
No. You called up and you chose violence. So we're here now. Let's square off. Why do I care what you think? I enjoy myself. I don't really care what you think.
Oh, that's fine. You know, I still love you, Rico.
I don't love you. So next thing. All right. What you got?
Yeah,
You chose violence.
I just would expect that out of Stoney.
I'm sorry. You expect weirdo.
What? Right, can we proceed?
No. He started this.
Okay.
You expect what? Because I like stars and astronomy? So that's a bad thing? Because what? Why?
It's not. Listen, man, I'm just giving you crap.
I don't really care. Let's go.
Right, you've established that.
Yeah, let's move on.
I'm just having fun with it, buddy. Anyway, this Tigers, man. I mean, this team isn't any good. I don't think Spencer Torkelson's any good. He's never going to be any good. And, Mike, I hate to beat a dead horse here, but, I mean, why in the F on a team that, you know, supposedly wants to be better sooner than later, are you drafting a player that is five years away most likely? You know, first of all, go get Langford. Just draft Langford. Make everybody happy. You know, I hate the Max Clark pick. Second of all, I want to ask you guys both of this, you know, this question here. How much better would this lineup look with J.D. Martinez, Chapman, and Langford?
Oh, night and
I mean,
day.
I think you can answer your own question for that, Paul.
That's night and day, Paul. I'm with you. Paul, look, I'm with you. And, like, just so I would never have to worry about the Scott Harris apologists, if you had just brought one of them in plus the draft pick, I'm with you.
That would have been nice.
I know. Look,
or if you would have went Chapman and Martinez.
Right.
You still would have been okay.
But I think when you make, you know, Paul, I think the point that really irked me was you draft Max Clark. All right, I disagree with it, but fine. They have different ideas, different designs. Maybe the kid is up by September of 25. I don't, whatever. But Paul, when you do that and then you double down and the only acquisitions you have while being $60 million under league average in payroll is a Mark Canha who, oh, well, he's hitting. Right. Are you telling me that a playoff team will have Mark Canha as their best player? Like, that was my issue.
No. And here's the other thing, Mike, is why am I looking at Matt Vierling at leadoff, Andy Ibañez in the two hole? This organization, this team, it's just so, so, so exhausting, man.
I know.
It's been a freaking decade. And you know what? I am so tired of these fans here. Everybody's going limp. Oh, you can do whatever you want, Scott. It's fine.
Well, you heard, did you hear?
To go to the ballpark to have fun.
Paul, did you hear what Scott Harris said to Chris Russo on High Heat?
Yeah, I you know, Mike, I damn near threw my phone at the TV. I was so upset at that.
He's punting this season.
It's Paul, it's crazy.
I am so tired of this.
It's crazy to Rico and I because you're right. It's been a decade. And it's not like they went 50 and, you know, 110 last year. They were 78-84. They finished second in the division. How could you not at least say, yes, our goal is to win this division?
They were interesting throughout the summer where we actually sat here and said, you know what? Maybe they can do something. You want to follow that up. You want to go get some bats. The division didn't get any better. You could win this thing, and you just chose, now we're going to stick with the young guys, and we don't have that right to feel that way yet. Then I don't know when ever get that.
I was screaming the entire offseason, please go get an effing bat. Because you know what I would rather do than watch this Tigers offense? Watch paint dry.
Yeah, it's tough.
I would rather watch
17 of the 18 innings. I mean, you can say what you want about the ninth. Closers are going to have off days. They're going to melt down. You're going to be able to steal one. I'm not mad about it. But, Paul, it's like, it's not like they hit a three-run bomb to walk this puppy off. I mean, it was a bloop, a throwing error, a hit batter. Hey, I'll take it. I'll take it. But I'm with you, Paul. You can't sell me that this is going to be how they're going to win games. You can't. And again, look, I disagree with Paul on one thing. You can't say a player's 5 years away. If it takes a player you draft 5 years to come up, that's a failed prospect. I don't want to put that on Clark. My whole thing is if Max Clark is the most advanced high school outfield, I mean, the best hope would be like late 25.
But the fact that they took him, now he has expectations, whether he's deserving it or not, that he's got to come in here and do something. He's not going to have a long runway where we're going to be patient because you're saying, well, we took you, kid.
The problem is Wyatt Langford broke camp with the World Series champions and is hitting in the middle of their order.
Right.
Okay.
But he's going to be they're going to be forever tied together.
Yep.
Fair or unfair. So when he finally makes it to the big league, okay, here's your chance. And you can't, well, give me a little bit of time. You don't have it.
You don't, you know, you're not getting that luxury.
Right.
248-539-9797. All right, Hungry Howie's just in time for baseball season. Nothing beats Hungry Howie's. And maybe, you know what, the pizza could keep you from falling asleep from watching the Tigers. So right now you get any one large one-topping pizza, if I could use my words appropriately, $6.99. Fresh dough made in-house daily, 100% real cheese, fresh ingredients, over 20 toppings to choose from, and of course, their signature flavored crust. It's Hungry Howie's. Make tonight's dinner a home run. Make it easy. Make it simple for $6.99 only at Hungry Howie's. Go to HungryHowie's.com or download the Hungry Howie's app to start your order now. Limited time offer, online carryout only. All right, we'll get to the people here in a second. And again, Red Wings are going to be the primary. Obviously, your Tiger thoughts. They're 7-4 after 11 games. You got 20 games left before the end of April. The bar is still the standard's the standard. You got to have a winning April for the first time since 2016. Stealing a game like today helps. You know, stealing a 1-0 game helps. But I think we all know deep down it's not going to continue. They have to play better baseball, specifically offensively. So you can comment on that. The Red Wings, it's the biggest regular season game they've had in damn near a decade. It's tonight. It's the Caps. You know, Kenny has called it one of the great goaltending matchups he's ever seen, Lindgren versus Lyon.
Never said that.
I swear you said it. No, it just, look, Caps are coming in on a 6-game losing streak. You could view it that they're a wounded dog and you're going to end it. Or isn't this the type of game the Wings dump? So that's in play, and I am going to bring up the national title game last night because I think there's a couple of takeaways. We can have some fun with it. F Purdue. I hate that university. It goes all the way back to Roosevelt Colvin ripping my heart out, 1996 on ESPN2. Nick Saban never should have lined up for that field goal.
The little cartoon graphics.
That's right, the spray paint graffiti.
Lowercase graphics.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Stuart Scott wearing a denim dress shirt. I hate Purdue. Passionately. So let's get to it. Kenny, ticket text, and we'll go to the callers.
I'm nervous, but I feel good that Washington's going through the stretch right now, and we already went through ours. They're in free fall, and they don't know where the bottom is.
How do you explain Washington and Philly's dueling free fall here of 6 games and 7 games? What is going on? It's like nobody wants the playoff spot.
I explain Washington because I don't think they were that good to begin with. If you look at their goal differential, it's dreadful. Philly's under full torts effect. They started off the year strong. He's doing the blood from a stone routine that he does every single place he goes. And now the team's finally getting a little tired. So that's how you explain those.
Tortorella's great for a very short amount of time. Love the quotes. You love how he is with the team. You love knowing he could basically punch a hole in a wall at any time. But you're right. It wears real thin.
He'll take you to the first round a couple of times, and that's about it nowadays.
You know what's interesting, though? As hard as he is on his team, comp that to Danny Hurley. Like, Danny, and look, I think the NIL and Portal era serves him well because I don't think you could be around Danny Hurley for more than 2 years. I don't know that that's possible.
No.
He's insane. No. In a good way, he's insane.
I mean, you saw it last night. Run the play my way.
Get out there, and you're like,
you're just
wait.
Dribbling. He walks out on the court, and he shoved a player and said, no, run the offense.
See, I've wanted to do that anytime State runs the weave.
And the referee had to blow. Wait, did you just walk out on the court?
That's okay. Insane.
Danny, you can't do that. You need to stay in the box, okay?
How about him woofing with Edie? Unbelievable. We'll get to it in a little bit. All right, let's get to the people. Andrew is hockey elite, and he is up next. What's up, Andrew?
Hey, what's going on, guys? How are we doing today?
Hey, ready for tonight. You tell me.
So basically, I had a different opening, but after the way Rico just shredded Paul, I'd like to just sincerely apologize about the last time I called Rico.
You're all good.
I hope you're having a great day, and I'm glad you got to use that PTO day to watch your sunset or whatever.
You're all good, Andrew.
I'm so sorry. Anyway, so basically, I have a different take on the Wings game tonight. I need them to shred them. I need line one to show up tonight and show them why they're not just backing into the playoffs. Mo's sick, so he's not blocking 10 shots tonight, I'll tell you that. DeBrincat's 7-for-17 when he's supposed to be a point a night, a guy. I need them to go in there and just completely shred the Capitals, 60 minutes and then hockey, only acceptable outcome.
I mean, it would be amazing. I think the best point you're making is your stars have to be stars. The later you get in the season, you have to be able. I mean, DeBrincat hasn't scored a goal in it feels like 2 weeks. Like, you got him to help carry you in stretches.
In a pressure game like tonight, step up, beat a man.
Kenny's the last time exactly. He scored against
That's all
the
it
Caps.
Boils down to, man.
Yeah.
Be a star. Show us that we're not going to get swept even if we get in the first round. Show it to me, please.
I have no argument. And by the way, here, I just pulled this up to make your point, Andrew. DeBrincat has one goal since, oh, my dear sweet baby Jesus. He's got one goal since Tuesday, February 27th. One.
Yeah, he's on a, oh, I'm sorry, what, you a said month and a half.
February?
Wow. One goal since they beat the Caps 8-3, and you came on the air offering Kenny champagne and cocktails.
And it was probably a garbage time goal, too. It was third period when they put five on them.
Wow.
So, no, that one doesn't even count. Go back another one.
Yeah, give me a meet. Well, go back. Well, it'd be the night before when they beat Chicago 3-2 in overtime. But your point,
okay,
well, Andrew, no, your point holds. Like, whether it's Kane, whether it's DeBrincat, you need your stars to be stars. Mm-hmm. And in a game like tonight, these goals do mean more. It does matter more. Shout out to the SEC.
Yep. At home.
And the one goal that DeBrincat did score in that time, against Washington also. Who do they play tonight? Washington? I think this is where he turns it around.
Synergy.
That's right.
Kenny, when do you relax tonight, or do you not relax?
When they pull the goalie and we score the empty netter. Or that.
I don't know what that have to do with anything. But
wow. Wow. Hold on. When's the last time DeBrincat had a multi-goal game?
That would be February 24th against St. Louis.
Mercy.
But when do you relax tonight?
When they score an empty net goal, or maybe when they go up four. I can't relax until the game's basically sealed.
When the crowd's chanting Jared Goff?
Yes, exactly.
Gotcha.
Perfect. Let's go to James, 97.1. James, how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing great. I will be doing better, man, but I was driving home from work and you were breaking my heart with feeling so nervous about tonight, buddy.
No, I know. Well, James, I don't want to feel this way. This team is untrustworthy.
Here's why you shouldn't.
Okay.
Here's why you shouldn't, because I think we're judging the Red Wings based on last year. When it's, you know, we to make the playoffs last year, they would have had to stay healthy all the way. But then someone gets hurt, and then you got Oscar Sundqvist, Pia Suter. Like, what are those guys stepping up? And this year, we got DeBrincat, Comfort Kane, Daniel Sprong, Shane Gostisbehere. It's an entire new playoff power play line, essentially. So I don't think that we're the Red Wings of last year. I think the Capitals and the Penguins are, and that's what we're seeing right now.
Okay. I actually don't mind that. That's fair. And look, I would feel better about some of the names you mentioned had they been playing better. I mean,
DeBrincat,
right, my God, you're a goal scorer. Yeah, if you're not scoring goals, what am I getting?
And I think that, you know, I heard the bullet holes from the seventh game loss. I think that Dylan Larkin coming back and that turning around is a really good argument for him being an MVP candidate for what he means to the Red Wings, like how Crosby is helping, you know, Pittsburgh go forward. I think that he should be in that conversation for sure. And, you know, Lucas Raymond's playing like crazy. David Perron's been, watch him tonight. He's going to be throwing his body everywhere, dude.
Yeah, but James, I do think that it may be a little bit from this year when they went through the period where they lost 7 of 8 games and 7 in a row, where a lot of people believed that this team had turned the corner. This was a playoff team. People thought that they were actually going to make some noise in the playoffs, and then the bottom just fell out.
It was like they all looked at an eclipse without their glasses on or something with that Larkin going, geez.
No, I know. Yeah. It's just one of those deals, man. I want to trust them. I hope they come through. It'd be really fun if they could win. It would set up another one Thursday night. But they'd be in a command position where all of a sudden you can start going, look, the pressure, just get a point. Mm-hmm. Just get a point out of this deal. Or if you win Thursday, you're in. Right. Period. Like, win tonight, win Thursday, you're in. You're making the playoffs. I believe that. Maybe
or at least build up the equity so if you happen to slip up in a game, you're not done.
Kenny, are they winning?
Yeah, they're winning for sure.
You say
Costa's
you were
got to be there. He's going to bring us a win.
Costa the mush. Lock,
which does what? Kills you. The Costa lock is stage 4 pancreatic cancer.
Is that where you guys got the little dancing cactus?
Yeah, and his record on Costa locks, he knows they're losing and still hands them out. Him being there,
I was about to say, he seemed very confident when he
put
that out.
That's why I'm scared. Anytime Jim's super confident and Costa locks something, it loses. That goes back to Grand Rapids.
He's going to do that. Wings will win, and then he'll go get some of Mom's spaghetti.
I heard he put the car flag on.
Nothing about this makes me feel good. We'll get more of your phone calls.
Real Italian dinner.
We'll get more of your calls, and I want to mix in a couple of thoughts on the national title game last night, including one about the Big Ten. We'll get to it. 97.1.
Brought to you by Applied Innovation. It's the biggest game of the year for the Red Wings. Yes, I know we've been saying that a lot lately, but it is especially true this evening. They host the Capitals at Little Caesars Arena, both these teams battling for the last wildcard spot. Forward Robbie Fabry says the Wings are still having fun, even though the playoff race does bring a lot of pressure. Wings enter this evening 84 points, holding down that second wildcard spot. The Penguins are the first team out, also at 84 points. Then it's the Caps and Flyers, both at 83 points. Mo Sider is sick right now. Flu's going around. He will likely play, though, tonight. Michael Rasmussen, though, out. And Alex Lyon's going to start between the pipes. We've got the pregame show at 6:45. Puck drop at 7 o'clock here on your home for the Red Wings. Tigers score 4 runs in the ninth inning, beating the Pirates in comeback fashion, also salvaging a 2-game series split in Pittsburgh. Gio Urshela tied the game with a single. Carey Carpenter then gave them the 4-3 lead with another single, and then another single from Jake Rogers made it 5-3. Next up for Detroit, a day off tomorrow, then a 4-game series against the Twins, tentatively starting at Thursday at Comerica Park. And the Pistons look to snap a 4-game losing streak at the Sixers this evening. Only 4 games left this season for Detroit. Tip off at 7 o'clock over on WWJ. At the Corwell Health Sports Desk, I'm Luke Sloan. For more, go to 97.1 The Ticket or Odyssey.com.
Five o'clock, great to have you, and it was perfect timing as Luke was doing his update. The NHL on ESPN showed Ovi marching into LCA, looking every bit like a 55-year-old father of four. Ovechkin, it's unbelievable. Guy's got 850 goals. He looks 850 years old. Like if someone was not a hockey fan and they just showed Ovechkin walking in the arena, they'd go, is that the player or the coach? There's not a person would answer player.
That's the guy that cleans out the trash bins, Mike. That guy looks that guy looked old a decade ago. He looks rough.
Can I offer something too? They also showed a stack because they got a double dip tonight. Do you know how many points Nikita Kucherov has?
So many points.
No. Do you know how
I don't know
many?
The number, no.
Okay. So who leads the Wings in points? Just give me the player.
Dylan Larkin?
No.
Really?
It'd be Lucas Raymond.
Oh, okay. That makes sense, yeah.
How many?
We're in the 70s of games. Say 55?
63 points.
All right, I'm close.
Nikita Kucherov. And if you want, Nate McKinnon. You know how many points they have?
90.
I was about to say, this is going to be embarrassing.
136 and 133.
Jesus. Hmm.
More than double our best players. I understand. We are cherry-picking guys who are having the two best seasons in the NHL from a productivity standpoint. But it is mind-blowing when you look at the context of, hey, the Wings aren't a bad team. This isn't like we're the San Jose Sharks. 63 points gets you tops here. Less than half of what those guys have done. I let it go to Kenny. How many points Kucherov have? Lots. 136.
Sounds like 90. Like,
absolutely
be embarrassing.
Insane.
I was like, point per game, that'd be somewhere in the 70s. So what's 1.5 point, 2 points? Jesus.
A zilly. But no, we're talking about the Wings. It is the biggest regular season game you've had under Yzerman. It's the biggest regular season game you've had probably in 10 years. It's tonight. It's the Caps. I love the fact ESPN's giving you a little walk up here while the update was going on. But I want to throw that number out, and then I also want to mix in national title game from last night. Not some breakdown of UConn and Purdue. It just the things, the takeaways, because Rico's here today, I am convinced after last night of a couple of things. A, factually speaking, you can run an offense without running that stupid weave, Tom.
B, that was for Izzo. B,
thanks, Mike.
The Big Ten is never winning a national championship in basketball again because we don't play the same sport. Purdue represented what I deem to be the best Big Ten team we've seen in several years and one of the better ones in the last two decades. You have a back-to-back national player of the year in Lurch, and you still couldn't get to within 15 points. I just, Rico, watching UConn, all jokes aside, they play a brand of basketball. It is arguably the best pure executed half-court offense I've seen in a long, long time in college basketball.
UConn played what I like to call a prove-a-point type of style of basketball. They came out there to show we're not only going to go back-to-back.
We're going to destroy everybody.
It's not going to be close. Like, teams are going to hold up, put up banners and say, hey, we had a lead against UConn. That's about the best you're going to get. What they did to Illinois is still somewhere in the corner sucking their thumb.
Tied at 23. Cutsy, 53-23.
30-0 run. I'm going to say this.
Uh-oh.
It's possible.
You're putting the cape on? You're going to do this for everybody? You're going to be Mr.
No,
Big Ten?
No. You're going to need more players, but you got to break away from Big Ten style of basketball. And to me, only two teams have tried to do that. Iowa, but they can't consistently get the athletes to play this game. Iowa plays no defense. They just want to run up and down the court. It's a guy who he just kind of Brad Underwood in Illinois. If Illinois plays a different style, I thought Illinois would have been the best chance this year. And then when they play UConn, you saw they couldn't match UConn horses for horses. They had some players, but UConn showed we got about six or seven guys. We could bring guys off the bench who are just as good as the starters. That's the problem. You got to break away from the Big Ten style of we're going to just kind of methodically go first one to 65
which
wins
is,
the game.
Once again, they're never winning one.
Yeah, that's it.
They're not winning one.
Illinois is trying to, and Underwood's going out in the portal and trying to, he's just stole AJ Storrs. Looks like he's going to go from Wisconsin there. If he can bring in the players, his mentality and the way he tries is their best hope. But you're right. Other than that, the Big Ten, you would have thought within the last 24 years as a whole would have said, guys, maybe we just need to change up our style and do things differently. But no, they keep believing, well, if you win the Big Ten, you got a shot. Yeah, you'll get a number one seed, but you won't hoist a trophy.
No, it's just, and again, UConn.
I mean, to put in perspective, the fact that in a second, Cleves' son is going to be playing college hoops, and his son may be the first one to win a Big Ten title since his father. That's how long it's been.
You mean Natty?
Yeah, Natty. Yeah, Natty. Yeah.
Let me help you. He's not winning one. So, I am in awe of what Danny Hurley has done because it's not what Nate Oates is doing at Bama. It's not all offense. They guard. They're physical. They attack you. They play it at both ends. They don't need to run to beat you.
They got the length. Yeah.
They'll execute in the half court, and they'll murder you. Dude, they run like 8 million screens.
How about this? They did something that everybody tried to do against Edie. They ran a double team at him, and Edie looked as if he had never been double teamed before, throwing the ball into the backcourt, just missing on passes. It was like you saw the frustration where he was forcing shots, and every other Big Ten team tried to do that. But UConn sends a guard about 6'2 at 80, and he freaked out and just lost it. So, yeah, I'm with you. The style that they play was, it's almost like when the spread offense hit college football and it was so different. And you're like, what are they doing? This is so different from what I'm used to seeing. Yeah, until the Big Ten changes, I'd like to sit here and say, Mike, this is hyperbole.
No.
I can't say that. I think Illinois may be the best bet because I don't see, maybe Dusty May brings in a different mentality at Michigan since he's new. He doesn't have the whole Big Ten stench on him.
And look, Beeline had two cracks at it. And if it wasn't for Luke Hancock or whatever that kid was, the kid for Louisville, or obviously, like, you, dude, they've had chances. I'm not saying you won't have bites at the apple, But it just feels like
the Wisconsin team in 2015.
Yeah, the Kaminsky team. Yeah. I just watched it. And also, here's the other thing. It shows you. This is where it shows you how far away not only the team is, but the coaching is. Danny Hurley is what Tom Izzo used to be.
Had that conversation this morning.
That's You're right.
Where Danny Hurley, I'm going to do, like you heard Tom saying, paraphrasing, you know, I'm going to do whatever it takes or die trying type of thing. Hurley actually will do that, where he came in and just said, this offense is garbage. I need new offense. What do I need to do to change this thing? And he did. And he brought in the players and he went into the portal and he got guys, and he has a machine right now.
And here's the other thing. I take great pride in this. I love the fact UConn now has 6 national titles in 25 years. Duke has 5 total.
They went into blue blood territory.
Well, for all of the sponge bathing the media does for Duke, UConn has more titles in 25 years.
The problem is, because when UConn is bad, they're horrific.
I'm fine with that.
But
you wouldn't take 6 titles in 25 years?
And that's just it. Yeah. 6 titles, you would. Even if it meant, well, you're not going to make the tournament in a couple of years.
That's why I never valued the streak. Yeah. I don't care. It doesn't add up to anything. Here's the last question. You could settle this. I have my own feelings. What is this narrative now bubbling up about, well, Zach Edey has to be drafted. Does he?
No. Unless you are a team, Zach Edey can be drafted, but he can be drafted in the second round.
So he's Luka Garza.
No, he's better than Luka Garza, but I get what you're saying. He's somebody that if you brought in Edey as part of your second squad and you just had an offense dedicated to him, dump it down low, let him do whatever he has to do, give him 10, 15 minutes a game, that works. Him for 48 minutes in the NBA, no, because that's not a position that the NBA values anymore. He's not shooting threes. He is just living and eating in the paint.
He just can't move. That's the biggest problem.
Yeah.
The game's moved on. It's not his fault.
Right, that's what I said. A second rounder, you bring him in, and you set up an offense just for him. When he's in there, that offense is all about getting it into Edey, slowing the game down, dump it in, and it's good for, I guess, a team with a lot of three-point shooters, because if you can double-team him, he throws it out, and they shoot the three.
Does he go lottery?
Oh, come on.
I'm asking. Unless he plays the
Powerball.
Okay,
no.
Hold on. All right, not lottery. Does he go first round?
No.
Okay. I just had to
No,
ask.
Because here's the thing. First-rounders are teams that are, you know, playoff teams late in the – no. I mean, to me, he's a second-round – luxury item that you can take a chance, and if he fails,
right,
you ship
what.
Him off to, you know, let's have city.
Let's have some fun. Put it on a board. Not because I think it's right. Somebody's going to take him in the first round. They will be a victim of hype and narrative. And look, I don't think per capita, I don't think there's a dumber collection of GMs in any league than the NBA. The NBA does some of the most unspeakable stupid things.
Wait a minute. Kenny, if he goes to the Pistons, now you open up all of those three-point shooters that Monty wants.
And you've displaced Jalen Duren. Okay, great plan. I quit.
You put Duren at the 4.
248-539-9797. But if you had some thoughts about last night, it's just, again, it's a dominating performance by UConn. Danny Hurley has built something you just don't see in today's college, in any form of college athletics.
You're right. This run reminds me of Izzo, the 99 to 2001, where he just, I'm going to do whatever it takes. He became addicted to winning, defense, toughness, rebounding, transition game. Like, all of that stuff happened. Even had the flair of running up and down and letting Mo Pete or Jay Richardson dunking the ball.
Cutscene. 248-539-9797. Rico, tell him.
Xfinity gives me a chance to catch up on my favorite shows while I'm on the go. With Xfinity Internet, I get the speed I need at a great price, and you too can get the speed you need at a great price thanks to the fastest internet on the largest gig speed network, delivering to more homes than any other network. So you can enjoy all your favorite apps all in one place with a Flex 4K streaming box, all with Xfinity Internet. Xfinity allows me to stream all my favorite shows without interruption. With college tourney now over and baseball starting up, you can get the latest scores as they happen, latest injury updates, your fantasy stats. Choose from a variety of speeds depending on your needs, including gig speeds up to 1.2 gigabits per second, and enjoy reliable internet on all your devices. To get started, call 1-800-XFINITY. Visit Xfinity.com or simply drop into an Xfinity store today for more details. Maximum download speed of 940 megabits per second when hardwired via Ethernet. Actual speeds vary and not guaranteed based on Xfinity's fastest available download speeds.
When it comes to an IRS collection or audit, you need a law firm that specializes in the resolution of all types of tax problems. You need Maurice and Jerry. You need Abraham and Rose. And whether it's personal income tax or business payroll taxes, you need Abraham and Rose. Not a random tax organization with a person on the phone who you'll never meet. Maurice and Jerry, they've dealt with the IRS, and they will advocate for you, fight for you, and guide you through the entire experience. So save your dollars and your time and hopefully some headaches. Visit AbrahamandRose.com today or call 248-539-5040, and you will never personally have to deal with the IRS again. All All right, to the people, number of topics in the hopper. Jeff is with us next on the ticket. What's up, Jeff?
Hi, Mike. How are you?
I'm good, pal. What's on your mind?
Well, I just called because I'm really furious with Scott Harris, and I've got a question for you. Mm-hmm. If he thinks that he's going to force feed all us Detroit Tiger fans with this version of a major league roster, then why doesn't he do something stand up for all of us fans? And every time this team is under 500, he reduces his ticket prices by a third. Because this is insane what he's doing to us. He's holding us hostage like we're responsible for his team being pathetic.
Well, Jeff, you don't like the new menu items?
Yeah. No, Jeff, no, Jeff, Rico, listen,
I mean. This is realistic. This
I get what you're saying. But, Jeff, you're going to you have a better chance of getting new menu items than anybody saying, I'm going to give you money back.
It just doesn't happen. I mean, Jeff, it doesn't matter in principality how right you may be.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. I mean, look, here's the problem, right? You got to bake this in. They hired this guy. What is he, 35 years old? Alleged very smart baseball man. Well, that doesn't mean we have to like everything he's doing. The idea that we're going to be now in year two, and look, long year ahead, but it's really hard to watch. 7-4, yeah, against the worst teams in baseball. Winning games 2-1, 1-0. You had a miracle today to steal one after doing nothing all day with one run. I am not hopeful. I'm not confident it'll continue. I really couldn't believe what he said in the interview with Chris Russo, basically saying, no, we don't have expectations. We haven't earned expectations. And I'm like, what? How do you just not go on TV and go, yeah, our expectations win Central?
Yeah.
What the hell else are we doing here? Yeah, like, the fact he couldn't say that, I'm like, what are we doing?
I agree. After hearing, I listened to what you said, and that's one of the reasons why completely infuriated with this man is because here we are. We got rid of Al Avila. He had his own issues, was poor. And this guy was a guy who, he has better knowledge of talent and he'll make smarter trades. But now they're not even willing to make trades. But then they give a guy who hasn't proven anything, Colt Keith, wasn't it something like $26 million to sign? He's never played Major League Baseball before.
Yeah, but hold on. That is something teams are doing around baseball. It's actually a smart investment. I don't hate it. I don't. Look, obviously things did not work out with Wander Franco for off-the-field issues. My point is, whether it was Ronald Acuna, whether it's Wander Franco, whether it is, you know, just any of these young stars, Cole Keith is here. It's going to take a miracle for him not to be here. I think he'll be okay. Mm-hmm. I'm not mad about it. They didn't sign with some $180 million super deal. This isn't Juan Soto.
But see, I think Jeff and people like Jeff are upset because you don't want to hear your president / general manager coming out saying, well, we're just going to punt this year. We don't have any expectation and we don't deserve the right to have this. Like, you want to hear, you want to win.
Well, here's,
you're a fan. You want to hear everybody in the organization and not even saying, we're going to win the World Series, and we got a division that we can go out there and take. And I think we got the players and something, but he just kind of, we win. And if we don't, you know,
well, here are the moves he's made. I think this is what people are tired of. Here are Scott Harris's moves. And I mean, this is what makes it look. Some of them are good. Some are bad, but like none of them are going to win a World Series. Like Matt Vierling. Nick Maton, Sands, Lorenzen, Carson Kelly, McKinstry, Ibanez, Kana, Maeda, Flaherty, Urshela, Holton, Englert, Matthew Boyd, Shreve, taking Max Clark over Langford upset a lot of people. The Erod disaster upset a lot of people. Look, in a vacuum, you can say bringing in Mark Canha, he's the best hitter on the team right now. That you can view that as saying, well, that's a great job by Harris. I look at it the other way. And go, that's an embarrassment if you can say that with a straight face. That means the roster is absolutely terrible. Okay? Like that.
No, I just.
So, no, it's
you
just.
You win.
That's the problem. And look, Rico, we got a lot of the people yesterday. We're getting a lot of them today. And there's a refrain. Now, do I think the people calling the show represent the majority? No, I do not. I think your point will stand the test of time.
I don't.
75% of people do not care enough to even know who these players are.
And for the record, I don't want to be right on this. I like it when I hear the people like Jeff who are angry, who are passionate, because you want victories, because you see a division that could be had, because you want, you know, an owner and the manager and every and general manager who looks like they're trying to do everything to win in a division that's winnable.
Oh, infinitely.
I mean, that's the frustrating part, because next year you can't say this, but this year you can say, you know what, we can win this thing. So you go out and you make moves. And when you look at the payroll, it's like, okay, it's not because we're overpaid. You're under payroll, at league average payroll. So what's the excuse?
Do you know how
Why are you not making the moves?
Do you know what the league average payroll is?
Yeah.
$164 million. You know what yours is?
Unfortunately, yeah.
$105 million. It's not close. Right. It's not like Rico and I are on the air bitching about not spending the extra $10 million in some imaginary line. You're not trying. Like,
it's almost as if you get a badge of honor by saying we won with a payroll this small.
And I mean, honestly, you'll play the Twins here coming up. The Twins are awful. Their best player's already hurt, and Royce Lewis, he's always hurt. But they can't score runs. Like, you have an opportunity here to rack some wins up. But mm-hmm. I just want to see the offense perk up.
Yeah. You get the Twins, yeah, it's 7 out of the next 11 games.
Ought to be a thrill a minute. All right, let's go over to Austin, 97.1. What's up, Austin?
Hey, Austin? Mikey.
Hey.
Dude, we need another Eclipse, man. I missed Stoney already. But, I totally agree with you about UConn. All I could think about watching that game last night was just they play, like, the perfect brand of basketball. They play great defense. They can shoot. And they'll abuse you in the paint with that Donovan Clingan guy. They're just such a well-put-together team. And it makes me sad as a Big Ten basketball fan because, like, I don't think – we have a team that looks or plays anything like no. UConn does. And as good as Purdue is, it just seems like all they do is feed Edie or just kick it out and shoot threes. And if they're the best program in the Big Ten, I mean, like, what shot does the conference have of winning an Natty?
That's my problem. And I'm in Austin. Look, Dusty May just got here. Like, I'll give him time to build. But, like, I don't know that Izzo's got another one in him.
No, Purdue's going to run back the same style of offense because they got another 7-footer sitting on the bench waiting to come in.
No, I Austin, I'm with you, man.
I thought it was Illinois.
Another one.
I thought it was Illinois, but they got embarrassed by UConn. 30-0 run on them.
So. What I'm tired of, Austin, is it's a lot like what we're talking about with the Tigers. Like, Big Ten basketball is just not entertaining. It's not fun to watch.
No,
it's not modern.
Not at all.
And it's like,
first
all
to 65.
Right. Then what are we doing? Like, there's no point to it.
And, dude, I'm a Buckeye fan. Like, watching OSU play Wisconsin or play Illinois or play Indiana, it's such a bad brand of basketball. I mean, like, is this the best we can do as a conference? Like, geez, dude.
I know. No, Austin, I know. And I don't know why they're so addicted to it. I don't know why there's this weird, like, oh, we have to live up to being, you know, brute force, physical.
Because
all it would take is somebody coming into the league and going, I'm not doing it that way.
Because that's just the way it is. It's like the Big 12 in football. Like, we're not going to play defense. We're just going to play video games. We're going to score. It's like certain conferences, it becomes a badge of honor.
Well, it's not here. If you haven't won anything in a quarter of a century, that's a bit of an issue. 248-539-9797. Kenny, any ticket ticks you want to get to?
Yeah, sure. Last night was terrible play by Purdue was key. The terrible guard play by Purdue was key. They were overmatched.
Yeah, they've been overmatched every year. They don't have good guards. They haven't ever had good guards.
Here's your by the numbers.
Right.
The number one.
3-point shots.
3 points made
UConn, by Purdue guards. UConn is just too good. UConn, as Mike and Kenny would say, is a wagon.
They are. But the problem is, look, obviously, UConn won't keep it going. I don't know that a three-peat is possible. The idea is it won't matter because even the other teams – around America in the Big 12 and in the ACC and in the SEC. I feel like the Big Ten is falling so far behind as a conference. And at one point, Michigan State and Austin, our last caller, the Buckeyes were the representative in this conference when Thad Mata had it rolling, when Tom Izzo had it rolling. Dude, all those programs are dead. Michigan is dead. We're dead. The Buckeyes are dead. Now I'm sitting here jealous of effing Nebraska.
Yeah. Yeah, the Indianas are gone.
Dead. Yeah. Also dead. Like, seriously, the people that are supposed to carry the banner.
Yeah, Matt Painter's not going to change his style. You're going to get the same style next year.
Great. Can't wait. Where will they? Where, are they going to build a bear to go find us a 7'5" player? Who's coming in next year? Who's Edie's understudy?
7'2", I think.
I quit. Fantastic. All right, NBA, NHL, baseball, all in full swing. FanDuel, your place to bet on every game. Right now, new customers get $150 in bonus bets guaranteed. It's $150, win or lose. You bet on everything, including, I mean, the home runs, the Dinger Tuesday promotion. You want to bet the Wings tonight? I don't know. What's a DeBrincat goal? Like plus 1,000 at this rate? Bottom line, FanDuel's got it for you. It's FanDuel.com/ticket. Make your first bet an automatic win. It's FanDuel, America's number one sports book. 21 and up, present Michigan. First online real money wager only. $10 first deposit required. Bonus issued. Not withdrawable bonus bets that expire 7 days after receipt. See terms. Sportsbook.fanduel.com. You got a gambling problem, call 1-800-270-7117.
Late game dramatics in Pittsburgh. The Tigers score 4 runs in the 9th inning, completing a 5-3 comeback win over the Pirates and salvaging a 2-game split. A single from Gia Urshela and a throwing error tied this one up at 3. That set up the pinch hitter, Kerry Carpenter. One more run for the Tigers in the 9th inning on an RBI single from Jake Rogers. Jason Foley then slammed the door closed, 5-3 the W. Detroit's off tomorrow, tentatively opening a 4-game series Thursday against the Twins at Comerica Park. The Wings host the Capitals this evening at Little Caesars Arena. This one is huge for the wild card race. Wings hold down the second spot with 84 points, then the Penguins the first team out also at 84 points, then the Caps and Flyers at 83. Mo Sider is sick, but head coach Derek Lalonde says he'll likely be suiting up and playing tonight. Michael Rasmussen out. Alex Lyons get a start and goal. That puck drops 7 o'clock right here on 97.1. At the Corwell Health Sports Desk, I'm Luke Sloan. We've got more at 6 o'clock or at 97.1theticket.com.
All right, 5:30, obviously, we're all gearing up for the Wings game, but let's just a mention of football, shall we, Kenny?
So the draft is quickly approaching.
Yeah, it is.
So I have a pre-draft list of winners and losers going into the draft.
Okay.
For various reasons. Number one on the list is the Atlanta Falcons for finally securing their quarterback, getting Mooney and Rondell Moore. They can now take the best player available at number 8 or trade to a quarterback needy team.
I have no argument. The only thing that separated them from back-to-back division titles was a functioning quality quarterback. I mean, Cousins, you don't have to love him. He's at least that.
I think for Atlanta, it really boils down to what the Cardinals do at 4. If there's no movement and the Cardinals don't trade and their fourth quarterback does not go, now Atlanta becomes that viable option, or, you know, your Giants come into play, Mike. But, yeah, I think pick number 4 is going to be the pick that kind of sets the whole draft night off.
And a loser, Arizona, because they didn't help Kyler Murray out basically at all. Much of Arizona's focus in early free agency was on defense. Not a lot of help for Kyler.
And it kind of goes to what I just said. If Arizona says, you know what, we're not taking the bait. We're going to go get Marvin Harrison Jr. and we're going to give him to Kyler Murray. And he's the best wide receiver in this. Then you feel like, okay, this makes up for you not going out getting offensive players.
Well, the problem is still they've never put a good offensive line around Kyler. And that I can't rationalize. You know, you take a QB number 1, you know he's tiny. I mean, why? But they're a shipwreck of a franchise. I mean, the owner's under investigation, the GM left in disgrace. The whole thing's a mess.
Winner is Philadelphia for prioritizing defense this offseason. They were 26th in yards allowed and 30th in points allowed last year in the NFL, bringing in Vic Fangio and a bunch of players on defense to help shore it up.
It looks good on paper, Kenny. I need to know mentally where the Eagles are, because they had an epic meltdown at the end of the year where I believed in this team, and I thought this team had all the personnel to go back to the Super Bowl, and by the end, nobody was picking them in the game against with Tampa. It was like, yeah, they were awful. So tell me that your coordinators are now good, that your head coach is good, and you got this under wraps, and we don't have to worry about getting your head of security kicked out and everything falling apart, and I'll believe in this Eagles team again.
I think he said it all. It's all about the locker room. It's all about whether that team even wants to play for Nick Sirianni anymore. That was a complete disaster.
And a loser, the Cowboys, for basically doing nothing. People will tell you that it was because of their limited cap space. But as we always say, this is the NFL and the cap is not real.
Whatever it is, they needed to do more. And I'm not telling you they should have had the biggest offseason, because the cap, there are limitations. But Rico, they did zero.
Yeah.
Absolute zero.
They did zero, and it's not like they were a team that was on the cusp or just lost out in the Super Bowl and said, we're just going to run it back with the same personnel. Got embarrassed again in the playoffs, and yeah, I mean, my goodness, Green Bay just took your heart early in that game, and you were never in it. So, no, I expected them to make some major moves. I don't know if it's because they're afraid of what Dak is going to cost them down the line, so they're trying to save pennies, but you should have did something.
And my favorite winner on here so far is the Houston Texans, bringing in Diggs, re-signing Dalton Schultz, Noah Brown, Desmond King, and getting Joe Mixon in the mix. They're in the all-win-now approach.
Yeah.
And they're a winner for
them. They have a rookie-scale QB. He might be the second-best quarterback in football. They're in a Super Bowl window. They recognized it. They did everything in their power to do it. And now, to me, I have no problem if you want to have a conversation of saying, hey, they're the biggest threat to the Chiefs.
The only thing that I'm hesitant about with the Texans is the sophomore slump with C.J. Stroud. You know, will teams catch up to him and you find out, okay, maybe he's not as good, they figured him out type of thing. But can he, if that is not true, then what Mike just said stands. Like, they're going all in. It's kind of the aggressiveness that I wanted to see a local team here have.
How dare you?
Where you just say, I don't care about next year. I'm only worried about this year.
And a loser, the Baltimore Ravens, because they literally lost too many players. Jadeveon Clowney, Patrick Queen, Josh Simpson, Ronald Darby. I mean, you name it, they've lost it. I think that makes them a loser.
What they didn't lose, though, was their defensive tackle pairing up the middle, which is dominant. They added Derrick Henry. Look, I just think the biggest—
And they're the Ravens, and they somehow always just find a way.
Well, and again, Lamar will find a way to end their season in the playoffs because he sucks. Sorry? Sorry?
The last winner on this
list.
You
get a half bill on that.
Okay.
The last winner on this list, which I might disagree with and call it a loser, but the Steelers for reshaping their quarterback room, if you want to call Russell Wilson a win, I don't know that I'd call it a win. I think he's a weird dude.
How about this? They've got two options. They've got hope at the quarterback spot. Did they have it before making this pair of moves? Absolutely not.
No, but I think we all see who the quarterback is, but for some reason, they promise Russ, you're going to get the first crack at this, and you're willing to throw away about 3-4 games this year. Hopefully you win a couple, because I think in the end, you're going to regret not just, you know, coming out and playing Justin Fields right out the gate.
And that is your NFL pre-draft winners and losers.
Get green, stay green with Natural Way Lawn and Tree Service, limited time only. You purchase a full lawn program, you get free grub control and insect control. All you got to do, mention my name or the station, and they got you covered. And look, the temperature swings, the snow, the cold, and then today it's 75. It doesn't matter. Let them get the first application of the season down. Let them get your lawn in order, and you can enjoy it, a weed-free lawn all summer long. So, certified applicators, custom-tailored solutions. Natural Way, best in the game, been doing it for over 30 years. Visit naturalwaylawn.com for all your lawn care needs, or simply call 888-GET-GREEN. That's 888-GET-GREEN. Natural Way Lawn and Tree Service. All right, Kenny, give me a couple of ticket texts, and then we'll get down to LCA for Game of the Millennium. What are you smiling about?
Evan had a very unsavory comment. I can't.
Well, can you tell me what it was in reference to?
It may or may not be true. It was something that happened on social media. Harbaugh was going to put the nameplate, like your high school recruiting ranking, on your nameplate. But then it was taken down, so Evan was like, well, you know, we're getting close to, you know, ridiculous things being put up in the draft when they talk to the certain players. And
I have no idea what's happening.
That's why I said it was just funny when I came in.
Oh, all right.
You wanted an explanation.
I was generally intrigued until you started talking.
No,
and then I'm like, I've asked a very bad question here.
I can't. Right. Because I can't say what Evan said.
Oh, okay. Delete that last minute from your brains. And I'd like to apologize to Metro Detroit. Kenny with the ticket text.
With Sider being ill, are we screwed even if he plays? Very worried about this team. I'm with you, Mike. I'm very nervous.
That's your boy, Kenny. You talk about it.
I mean, he blocked like 10 shots. He might have his Jordan flu game here. This is what's going to happen.
Oh, is this where they carry Mo off the ice?
It'll propel us into the playoffs. This will be the defining moment in the season, just like Ottawa was last year, the other way.
How nervous you get 2.5 minutes into the game. Washington scores. 1-0. LCA hushed. Come on, talk to me. Take me through it.
I know
you're nervous.
My concern is because I've seen them do this. They get scored on first, and they just turn the engine off. They're like, nope, all right, that's it. We give up. That you got us. That's the
impossible
whole game.
Impossible tonight.
Impossible tonight.
Impossible tonight.
But when Larkin was gone, they'd go down 2-0 and be like, they're going to chase the puck the rest of the game. It's not going to go well. They're going to stand around in their own zone. I've seen this team do this in that 7-game losing streak. I saw Derek Lalonde basically give up his head coaching card and his key to the building. I don't know what happened there. I'm terrified that if they go down, we could be seeing some of the same.
Do you still feel that tonight is one of the great goaltending matchups in modern NHL history?
I never once.
Lindgren versus Lyon. Come on.
No. I never once said that.
Go ahead.
It's the 2014 against the Twins to clinch the division with Joe Nathan. That's what would be the best regular season game.
That's a decade.
I agree with Mike. The Wings are giving me every reason to be nervous, but something inside of me says they get it done tonight.
And are we? Where are we at with Jim Costa's presence at this game?
I was going to say, if they win, does the Costa lock now mean something?
No. The Costa lock is poison.
Okay. But if they win.
It's cyanide. The fact that he took the air this morning, guaranteed a win. The fact that I think
he went to social media as well.
I think what should happen then is if they lose, all of you in listener land should blame him. That's really the only fair way. He guaranteed it, and he bought tickets to go tonight. He's going to be wearing one of his little stupid jerseys. He's going to look like Ferris Bueller's best friend. Cameron.
The Costa lock.
It's bad. You don't want to be Costa locked. Go ahead, Kenny.
Here's one of my favorite ones that came in within the last hour. Ovi looks like the 3,000-year-old Romanian vampire in the Twilight movies. That's from Tom and Flat Rock.
Not far off. It is not far off. He looks like a guy who works in the concrete industry in Long Island.
I was about to say, I'll have to take your word. I didn't see any of the Twilight movies.
Dude, I didn't. I'm saying when you watched ESPN showing Ovi walk into the arena.
I saw that, but yeah. Never saw the Twilight.
I'm shocked. You like all things nerdy. All right,
Twilight.
I don't even know what Twilight is. Kenny, what do you want to do? Take a text.
I got one more text for you. With Costa downtown, we don't stand a chance. The Costa lock, in combination with him being at the game, is too dangerous for the Wings to overcome.
As Rico says, it's just too hot. It's combustible.
I got to tell you guys, calm down. I've never done a lock before. I'll give you the Rieger lock. There is no way the Wings lose this hockey game. There is no way. The Capitals are toast, guys. They've lost 6 straight. They're a minus 41 goal differential. 6 games in a row, only scoring 2 or less. Come on. The Wings have earned your trust at least to beat this bum of a team.
Oh, really? Coming from the same guy who wanted Lalonde fired like 10 minutes ago.
So hey, you know
I'm
what?
Not trying to hear you be the bastion of confidence now.
No, but you know what? I am willing to say, Derek, nice job. Because at the lowest of lows, they found a way. They've got points in the last 3 or 4 games. They're playing better hockey.
I agree with all of it. But I can't. You can't trust them. All they do is hurt you. You got to just hope.
I think they win, and I think they win big.
Oh, God.
That's what I think.
Hold on. To add to the Costa lock, Rico,
the Rieger lock.
Yeah, now you get Rieger betting the puck line. It's like this is combustible.
Winning big.
Listen, I haven't checked it. I haven't checked it, guys. Sorry to cut you off, but Wings minus a goal and a half, what is it? I would bet it. I'm that confident. No, guys, seriously, they got the crap out of their system, and you even mentioned it, Mike and Rico. Like, this race for the ace seed, every team has lost seven, then they get hot. Like, the Penguins were dead and buried and in a coffin, and then they won four in a row, and now they're right there. But the Wings have got past the garbage part. Now they've played good hockey. I think they come out today. Not to mention, they have a little revenge themselves. The last time the Capitals won was 6 games ago or
Are
seven
you ready?
Games ago.
So Rieger.
When the Wings lost to them.
The Wings,
so they
win,
got revenge on
Wings
them.
Win by how many goals tonight?
I think they win by 2 at least. 4-2, I'm thinking.
Plus 170.
I'll do it. Let's go.
Do it with Rico, but it's got to be two lunches for one.
We're
right,
still,
so I get the odds, right.
Yeah. We're still waiting on the pass.
Well, okay, so hold on. I owe Rico two Chipotle suppers, okay? So if I win this bet,
it's even. You're even, Steven. And if you lose,
okay, but if I lose,
you own
three. Let's do it. You in, Rico? I got Wings by 2 goals. Goal and a half.
You know what? I'll take the bet, but you still owe me one because I want something out of
this. Wow. All right.
No. No bet then.
You two can sort this out on the side.
Okay. Oh,
you guys
cares about
are the lead up to the game of the millennium. We'll talk to everybody at 2.
Bye, guys.
Hopefully the Wings get this done and we can have a happy show tomorrow. 97.1.